श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा श्री कृष्णा गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरु साक्षात् परम ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। You all have known and studied Bhagavad Gita. This was the introduction about you given to me. And therefore, I am extremely afraid to talk in front of you on Bhagavad Gita, yet I will try. There are a few things which I will tell. First of all, who heard and who talked in Bhagavad Gita? The teacher and the student pairs. There are four teacher-student pairs in Bhagavad Gita. First is, Bhagavan Sri Krishna spoke, Arjuna heard. Second is, Sanjay spoke, Dhritarashtra heard. Third is, Bhagavan Sri Krishna spoke, and by the grace of Vedavyasa, the Sanjay heard. Three pairs. And fourth, I am talking to you, and I hope you are listening. Now, out of these four, what happened to whom? See, first, Sanjay spoke to Dhritarashtra. After the whole Bhagavad Gita was narrated, nothing happened to Dhritarashtra. He continued to be dumb. Because you can wake up somebody if somebody is sleeping. If somebody is pretending that he or she is sleeping, you cannot wake him up. Friends, the first principle of life is we must be adaptable to change ourselves according to the need of the place and the time. If we don't change ourselves, we will be erased from this world. See, there was a great Mahatma in Rishikesh, very orthodox. According to that orthodoxy, he used to hate people talking on scriptures in English. I remember many years before when I went there, he told me very clearly, "You people talk English, we don't like people talking in English." So I kept quiet. There you can't even laugh in English, you have to laugh in Hindi. There's no tragedy. After the time passed, the same Mahatma, he came and told me, "Will you please translate my Sanskrit commentary into English?" See, what is necessary is we have to adopt and change ourselves. If we don't adopt and don't change, we will be erased. This is the first principle. See, now here you have come. Are you staying in the hostels here or come from home?
Hostels.
Hostels. Home, or some are from hostel and some are from the home. So those who are staying in the hostel, they are lucky. And those who are coming from the home, again the same mom, the same dad, don't do this, don't do that, isn't it? Anyway, accept the things as they are and adopt yourself. If we cannot adopt, you will be out of this world, number one. Then what happened to Sanjay when he heard Bhagavad Gita from Bhagavan Sri Krishna directly? He himself tells that when I think of that, I am extremely happy. See? So this is what happened to Sanjay. What happened to Arjun? He says, "All my confusion is gone and I am clear about what is my role at the given moment." Three. So what is exactly the message of Gita? There are 1.5 dozen yogas in Gita. Every chapter concludes with a yoga. Om Tassad Iti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Su Upanishatsu Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre Sri Krishna Arjuna Samvade अर्जुन विषाद योगो नाम प्रथमोध्याय फर्स्ट योगा सेकंड योगा थर्ड योगा 18 योगा आर देयर एंड अर्जुना डिड नॉट प्रैक्टिस एनीथिंग ही वाज ऑन द बैटल फील्ड on the battlefield, both side armies, and he can't say, excuse me, I have to do meditation. No. Then what happened? See, friends, only one thing happened. And that is the biggest problem for every one of us. The problem is identity crisis. For him, war was not the problem. That was his professional. See, he was the Sachin Tendulkar of his time as regards wars are concerned. Always successful, never failed. But when it came to this final war, he was totally confused. This identity crisis is the cause of everyone's misery. See, friends. We are at a time, so many, be attentive, I am just giving you this example. I am a man, this is not example, this is reality. I am a man, with reference to my father, I am called as son. I am a man, with reference to my wife, thank God I don't have one. With reference to my wife, I am called as husband. I am a man, with reference to my son, I am called as father. Now, how many I's I are? 1, 2, 3, or 4? And out of these 4, the man, the son, the husband, and the father, out of these 4, who is suffering in this world? See, the son suffers, the man never suffers. The husband always suffers, the man never suffers. One day, one husband came and spoke to me. Swamiji, please help me. I said, I cannot help you now. I can only pray for you. I can help somebody before marriage. You know, after marriage, there are no blessings. There is only prayer to the Lord. Oh Lord, please protect him, poor fellow. So he came and he told me, I am so fed up of my wife. I am so miserable. What should I do? I said, think. Very simple. Tell me, by birth, you are husband or you are man? By birth, you are man. So, remaining as a man is your natural state. Becoming husband is unnatural. So, whenever you are in an unnatural disposition, you can never be happy. So for you at this moment, you are naturally student. So focus your attention on your studies and do your best, you will never be miserable. But instead of that, if you keep on going here and there, and your mind runs, and then you will be miserable. Therefore, all miserable when we are unnatural. Remain yourself. Then you will not be tired, you will not be exhausted, you will not be confused, you will not be bored, you will not be lonely. You will be full of cheer and joy. It is possible. See? Now what is the reason that we are unable to achieve this natural state of happiness? I will give an example. It happened in England. I came from Bombay to London, Heathrow Airport, 9 hours flight. Before that, 2-3 hours to go to airport, so 12 hours. After I landed, one lady, a European lady, she came to pick me up. And from there, we are going to some church for giving a lecture. And when she was driving, I said, Mama, probably you have taken a wrong exit. She became furious. Swamiji, what do you know? I am here for last 35 years. I said, that doesn't disqualify you from making mistakes. No, I know everything. I said, okay, go ahead. After going for about half an hour, he said, Swamiji, probably you are correct. We have taken a wrong exit. What should we do? I said, follow Indian technique. Go wrong way. See, in India, why there are less accidents? Because when some people go right way and some people go wrong way, then there are accidents. in our country, everybody goes the wrong way. So everybody is right. How simple it is. So she said, no, there is no possibility. We'll have to go a long way and take a U-turn. I said, do whatever you like. We reached a church 1 hour late. And I was hoping that all those people must have gone, but they were still hanging around. So I had to go and talk to them. To them I spoke on Gita. Gita for everyone. After about 1.5 hour of talk, we had tea, coffee, and I went to my hostess' place, had dinner, and thereafter, I was watching a documentary on Tibet. Now this lady who came, she said, Swamiji, go and take rest. I said, look here, I am not your baby, okay? I may call you mama. Leave me myself. No, 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 you must be tired, etc. It is not your business, I am okay. No, not that way. Then what way? How come you don't get tired? I want to be like you. I said, mama, you cannot be like me. Why? No beard. Longer the beard, stabilized is the wisdom. Short the beard, doubtful is the wisdom. You being a woman, no beard. No wisdom. No, 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 no. Please help me, tell me how it is possible. I said, look here. What is the struggle of your life? It's for every one of us. The struggle is, you are trying to prove something to somebody. Don't do that. We unnecessarily struggle. Be yourself, you will be at home. But all the time, we try to prove that I am smarter than you, I am better than you, I am a goody-goody. These goody-goody characters are very dangerous. See? Relax. If somebody calls you a fool, you don't have to react. You tell him that you have not understood me fully. I am from Maharashtra, therefore Maha-fool. In Maharashtra, there are not ordinary fools. Everything is Maha there. The day you understand this principle, stop reacting in life. What happened to Arjuna on the battlefield? Instead of acting, he started reacting. His reaction was, how can I kill my grandfather and my guru? Meaning what? Killing is not a problem. Grandfather and guru is not a problem. Problem is, my grandfather and my guru, how can I kill? If it is your grandfather, your guru, I don't mind. See? This identity crisis creates all the problem in our life. Now on the battlefield, who are we? Are we a grandson or a disciple or a warrior? Exactly. Now at this moment of your life, you are a student, a daughter, a mother, a father. Who are you? At this moment you are a student. Simply follow what is expected out of a student. You will have no confusion. But instead of that, we go the wrong way and regret thereafter. I'll give an example. Recently I spoke to a group like you in another university. And there I had to speak in Hindi because they said we don't know English. So, the whole thing is very simple. It's not difficult. When we are studying, our problem is our mind goes here and there. And because of that, we don't succeed properly as expected of us. So to make this point, I gave them an example. I said, you know, I went to one of my doctor's pathological laboratory in US. And he took me to his clinic and showed me the whole thing and introduced me three girls. They were the technicians in his dispensary or pathological laboratory. Swamiji, this is Mary, and I don't know the name. So let us imagine, this is Mary, this is Terry, this is Uski. The three girls were told. After that, he said, Swamiji, they are so expert, so genius, that when they do the analysis of the blood or urine or whatever, I blindly sign and I get my job done. I hardly come even to the clinic. I said, may I talk to them? He said, yes, you can talk. So I asked one of them. I said, hey, when you are so genius, so intelligent, why didn't you become doctor? Instead of doing this technician job and he is earning on your behalf, why didn't you become doctor? She asked me, excuse me, mister, whatever is your name, are you from India? I said, yes. Oh, you guys are different. I said, what different? Do we have horns and a tail or what? He said, no. Here, when we are 13, 14 years of age, our parents push us out of the house. And they say, fend yourself. If you have to stay in the same house where I was staying till the age of 13, in the same house, same room, same bed, if I had to stay, I have to pay $200 a week. I had to earn. There is no support from the parents. They say, you have to earn, we will not support you. They'll keep the dogs, but not the children. And therefore, we have to go and work in the public, in the hotels, in any place. And once you start getting exposed to the unwanted exposure, slowly, slowly, self-control is lost. And by the time we are hardly 18, 19, 20 years of age, the productive period of our creativity is completely destroyed in unwanted occupation in this world. And thereafter, we have no strength, we have no interest, and therefore we end up doing some course here and there so that we can earn our bread and butter. Now see how lucky you are. If we become aware of this, then you will never have this identity crisis as to what for we are here. See, friend, don't keep a long-term goal. Keep short-term goals in life. Whatever we are supposed to do, do it perfectly well and you will be happy. See, and for that, what is required is our mind must be under control. If you control your mind, you have controlled the whole world. If the mind is ruling over us, we are completely gone. Therefore, we all the time have to keep this awareness as to who am I at the given period of time. Now, for example, here, I am talking to you on some topic, so I am a speaker, and you are the listeners. So, other than these two relationships, there is no third relationship should ever pop up in our life. The net result will be, we will be fully available to whatever we are listening. The real genius is the one who catches the point in one go. And as a result, you are always alert. See, when you are alert, you are in the present. When you are not alert, you are not in the present. See, and when you are in the present, you are alert, you are happy. And when you are happy, you have broken all the barriers of individuality and you merge in the totality. See, friends. So, the real lifestyle is always remain cheerful and happy. See? Take one example. What is the meaning of remaining in the present when you are happy? I'll give an example. There was one young boy like any one of you. In Delhi it happened. He was riding his motorcycle and he was driving and there was a red light, traffic light, and yet he jumped, he went, crossed the red light. And out their side, police was waiting, stopped him. And the police became angry. Didn't you see the red light? So the boy was very cool. He said, I saw the red light, but I didn't see you. And therefore I jumped. See? Now at this moment, those who have understood the joke, there are two types of people, those who understand the joke in one go, others never understand. And then they ask the next person, hey, what happened? And when he comes to know, this is the second type of laughter. So they are like the tube lights, they don't catch it quickly. So when you are happy, that time you are neither man nor woman, neither young nor old, you are. And when you are in the utter present, you are full, you are complete. That experience of completeness all the time is the beauty of life. Wherever there is a sense of incompleteness, we suffer, we struggle. And the technique is this. Whatever we are supposed to do, do it wholeheartedly. Don't do it with a hole in the heart. Anyway, I'll do it. This is what happens in the morning, isn't it? Morning, you wake up, oh, it is 5:28. It is not a round figure. Let it be 5:30. So why waste 2 minutes? So go to sleep. Again, you look into it. Oh, it is 5:47. Oh, 3 minutes still. It is not a round figure. Again, you go to sleep. And ultimately, you have to somehow come out of the bed. And such a person who doesn't begin his life in an inspired mode, he is simply living through carrying the burden of life. See? There was a mother, she was telling her son, "My dear child, get up, you have to go to school." "No, mama, I don't know, no, no." Again he slept. Again after 10 minutes she came, "Mita, come on, get up, you have to go to school, get ready." "Mama, I don't know, no." Again he slept. Finally, 8:30, the mother said in a decisive version, "You have to get up and get ready. It is already getting 9 o'clock. You have to leave now." So the son also got angry. "Why should I get up and go to school?" He said, "Because you are a principal of the school. You have to go." Imagine if the principal of the school is of this quality, what will be the quality of the students? Friends, unless we are inspired, we cannot motivate others. Then life becomes a burden. Any person who carries life as a burden can never, never be cheerful and happy in life. Therefore, all that is required for us, first principle, we have to remember as to what we are at a given period of time. So when you are driving a motorcycle, remember now you are only driving a motorcycle. You must have seen here, they will be keeping the phone like this thing and driving here, and the other hand they will be eating also something, and then what kind of cartoons? Try this. One thing at a time. You will be fully available. Why we are not able to focus in our life is only because of this. It is something like this. If you have to pump air, pump water on the top of the building, you start and a pipe should take it on the top. But unfortunately, the pipe is holy. There are many holes on that. So all the pressure that is developed is leaked out in the same manner. We all have infinite potentiality. But instead of achieving the success, we have got so many holes. Those holes are called as sense organs and organs of action. All our energy is lost through them. And therefore, when it is required, it is not available. See, friends, for understanding how we waste our energy, I'll give some example. It is just for calculation purpose I am giving. 8 hours of physical work, energy requirement is equal to 1 hour of energy requirement for 1 hour talk. 8 hours of talk, energy requirement is equal to 15 minutes of intense thinking. So if you want to really think and understand, all our energy must be conserved. And this is the time of your life when we are most likely to waste our energy either in sleeping or daydreaming. See, friends, to get out of sleep is never a problem. to get out of the bed is the biggest problem. So the time lag between coming out of the sleep and coming out of the bed, that determines whether we are conserving our energy or we are dissipating our energy. For example, suppose we come out of the sleep, but we don't come out of bed. During that time, what we do? Observe tomorrow. Sleep is over, but we still keep on sleeping on the back. If the back starts spinning, we come on the left side, and the left side starts spinning. Then we come on the right side. Like a dosha, we do this way, that way, keep on. And finally, we come on the stomach, bhujangasana. And then the pressure develops. And then naturally we get up. See, during that period of 15, 20, half an hour, what we do? All unwanted thinking. And during that unwanted thinking, what happens? Like when you go to sleep, you put your mobile phone for charging, so whole day is available to you. In the same manner, when we go to sleep, we plug ourselves into the divine energy. So we are all charged up. But then when we come out of the sleep and don't come out of the bed, during that period, all the energy that we have charged ourselves is dissipated in that unwanted thinking. And thereafter, you don't feel like getting up, you don't feel like doing anything, and then we drag through life. Just give it a try. The moment your sleep is over, bump out of your bed. Don't hang around. But you know, I have nothing to do, keep running. Go anywhere, do some physical thing. But don't allow again to go back to the bed. Once the simple thing is taken, you will discover one day, very simple thing, that you will remain inspired for the whole day. How you begin your day determines how you live through the day. Like, you know, these people who are who take part in race, 100 meter, 1000 meter, I'm not talking about marathon. 100 meter, 1000 meter race, they are standing there waiting for the signal. The moment the signal goes, they don't run, they shoot like a bullet. If I had to stand along with them and signal goes, I'll be holding on my lungi like a Malayali, and then by the time I think about running, they will already reach there. See, I was telling Ram, in Bombay, one child asked me this question. Swamiji, in Kerala, there is 100% literacy, yet why Kerala is not a progressive state? I said, I don't know, Baba, I am not educated, I am illiterate. He said, no, it's very simple. What is simple? He said, all the Keralites are busy in doing and undoing their lungi whole day. And therefore, they don't have time to do anything creative. See, friends, relax and remain inspired. Inspired person alone is relaxed. On the battlefield, when Arjuna was crying, Bhagavan Krishna was not joining with him. No, beta, come on, we have come for a war. We should play the war and go. You can't. No. On the contrary, he laughed at him. Klaivyammas magama partha. Arjun, don't yield to impotency. Impotency means lack of inspiration. My friends, inspiration is a catalytic agent in our life. And it can be added to every chemical process. Common. Ordinary student, inspired student. Ordinary teacher, inspired teacher. Ordinary husband, inspired husband. Can you imagine inspired husband? There are. One day one man went after my talk home, and he was so much inspired. He said, I have decided to be inspired husband. Went home, knocked the door, and when the wife opened the door, he lifted her and was going towards the dining table. She said, "What happened to you, man? You are coming from satsang? Was your Swami romantic or what? What happened?" No, he was not romantic. Then he told, "You must carry the burden of your life." Relax. This is the most important spiritual practice. Relax. And if you are relaxed, you are inspired. Inspired and relaxed person alone can have a perfect balance in life. Don't take life too seriously. So whatever we are supposed to do, do it cheerfully, carefully, happily. And always remember to smile. See? And once you decide this, you will see this world is a very big mega cartoon show. And then from this world, you can learn so many things. Like I tell you, most of my learning is only from you people. I have not studied much, hardly anything. But when you observe, you learn so many things. See, like the other day in US, when Amma was there, in one of her talks, she said something so unique. You must have seen, you know, those radium signboards. They don't have their own light. But when the light of the car falls on those signs, they become very bright. Exactly the same way. We don't have our own light. But when the light of wisdom falls on us out of an ordinary Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, a Mahatma Gandhi's born. And that source is not outside. It is within. And that source is you, not anywhere else. Now what is happening? That we are not available to ourselves. And therefore, we are constantly complaining. We are constantly depressed and dejected. No, friends. Never seek any support from outside. Discover your inner strength. And to discover the inner strength, start working on your mind. Now be attentive. We all take care of our house. House should be properly painted. Fixtures should be nice. Furniture should be matching. Carpet should be beautiful. It should be clean. Very good. Take care. We take care of our clothing. Everything should be matching. See? Red nail polish to the toes. Red, whatever you call the lower band, red kurta, red .com, red polish here, red purse, red car, red carpet. Why? Matching. Very good. Nothing wrong. Then we take care of our figure. I don't want to eat that. Why? More cholesterol. I don't want to lose my... Very good. Nothing wrong. What care we have taken about our mind. Like we work by the body and we work on the body. Two things. When we go and earn our bread and butter, we are working by the body. Like you are coming and studying here, you are working by the body. Working on the body, when you go to the gym, when you start running, when you do exercise, that time you are not working by the body, you are working on the body. Apply the same principle. We are working by the mind. Are we working on the mind? Now the question is, what is the meaning of working by the mind and working on the mind? So working by the mind means, we all have default settings in our system. What are the default settings? Anything we see, we have to give a comment. There is no need. I was in Anandamayi Ma's ashram in Gujarat. And a very beautiful place just on the banks of Narmada River. And there, near her picture, there was a small beautiful thing written in Hindi. All of you know Hindi, I know. Dekho सुनो बोलो मत, सी हियर डोंट टॉक. नॉर्मली व्हाट वी डू, एनीथिंग वी हैव सीन वी हैव टू ऐड ए कमेंट और वी हैव टू कंपेयर और वी हैव टू गिव सजेशन और वी हैव टू कलेक्ट इंफॉर्मेशन. वी बीइंग इंडियन, लाइक यू नो आई मूव सो वेरी प्लेसेस. Every time the same question, Swamiji, where are you from? Why were you born? When were you born? Why don't you die? There is no need. Keep on collecting so much information, and that information has no value. This is because we are working by the mind. See, I'll tell you an example about this. Be attentive. Once I was traveling many years before, must be about 30-40 years before, traveling from Delhi to Bombay. Naturally, 40 years before, I was also young like you. Young, smart, handsome, etc., etc. So when I was traveling by train, those days, recently those AC chair cars have started. So I got a seat in the center. Left side there was one huge Sindhi person sitting, flowing out of the seat. Next to me, he was on the left side. Right side, there was one young girl sitting, and I was sandwiched between the two. Now you can imagine, whole night journey. Now this person I had to push, and he was very hefty, heavy, well fed, and I was fed up. And this side is girl. Now you can imagine, I am a young Swami and whole night I had to pass. So I was all the night, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya. And somehow the whole night I have gone through. Morning when I went to the bathroom, I said, excuse me, I had to go to washroom. I went and came back. Then she asked me, where are you going? I said, wherever the train takes. No, by the way, I asked you. I said, I don't go anywhere by the way. I go the right way. Oh, you talk sense. I said, yes, I am not nonsense. Naturally, I had to also ask some question. You are going to Bombay for some work? Yes, I am going to Bombay. I finished my education in engineering. I am a software engineer. I am going there for a job. I said, for what? So I get a job and then I will be happy. I said, very good. Now tell me, do you want happiness after reaching there or right now? Do you want happiness after getting the job or right now? Do you want happiness when you will be struggling and thereafter? Do you want to be happy after getting married or before getting married? Do you want to be happy after having a good house or right here? He said, of course, I want right now. I said, when you want happiness right now, why you think about that? Be now. We all only imagine. The real happiness is, wherever you are, effortlessly, you are at peace with yourself. A person who is at peace with himself, he alone is at peace with the whole world. A person who is at war with himself, he cannot be at peace with the whole world. Take an example. So let us start working on the mind with this example. So instead of reacting and having a default settings of the mind, let us start working on the mind. Now what is working on the mind? Working on the mind is disciplining the mind from two angles. Angle number one. When we talk to others, ask a question, not to others, to yourself. Is it necessary to talk? Many a times we talk, afterwards we regret. You must have seen in your houses, old ladies particularly, they have this uncontrolled habit of talking. So they will be telling, our neighbor's daughter-in-law is far better than our daughter-in-law. I know I should not say this, but why don't you keep your mouth shut? But we talk, and thereafter we regret. So just try this. Before we talk anything to anybody, ask a question. Is it necessary to talk? without any pressure on yourself, you will be at peace. One practice. And when we talk to others, we talk either about our past or about somebody else's topic. And both of them are not essential. The second is, stop talking to yourself. Give it a try. Right away. Next 30 seconds, do not talk to yourself. Experiment over. Now see, what did I tell you? Do not talk to yourself. Did I tell don't talk among yourself? Why didn't you talk among yourself? Because when you are not talking to yourself, you will not talk to others. But what happens? We have got so much of garbage inside. We are constantly talking. And then we want somebody to listen. So we go and tell. Give it a try. Don't complain. Swamiji, when I study, my mind runs here and there. Be attentive. Mind never runs anywhere unless you start talking yourself to yourself. Don't go into that yoga definition. Chitta vritti nirodaha yogaha. Control your mind. And what is the control of the mind? We tighten our fist and bite our teeth. Nothing is going to happen. Contrary to this, remember simple principle. When we come out of the house, we are dressed properly. In the same manner, when the thoughts come out of the mind, thoughts are dressed in the clothing of words. Try now. Without using any word in your mind, think. You cannot think. So instead of struggling, control the thoughts, control the mind. This is simpler. Stop talking to yourself. If 10 seconds, 30 seconds we can do, we can also do it for a longer period of time. And the more you are at peace with yourself, you will be at peace with the whole world. That is what is called as happiness. Happiness is not joining the laughing club. Are there laughing clubs here in Kerala? Or Keralites never laugh? I was in Bhopal before coming here. Right opposite my place of stay, there was a nice garden. In the morning I used to go for a walk. So, there used to be about a dozen old people with the pot belly and the terrible disposition. And they will be standing around. And they are instructed to teach how to laugh. You can imagine. Those people who are required to teach how to laugh, how disgusting their life must be. So the teacher will be standing in the center and all these people with different shapes or no shape rather, they are standing there. And then you say, okay, now we will laugh, okay? And when I clap three times, then you have to say, ha ha ha, okay? And this is how the laughing lessons were given. So he did tap, 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 then all these people, ha ha. Not like this. You should laugh loudly. Again, little more loudly. Two, three times he did it. And then these people got angry. Okay, loudly, loudly. Now listen. So he did again three times. And they said, ha, 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 very loudly. And forgot that they have dentures in their mouth. And all the dentures were offered as oblation to the Mahayagya of laughing. And all the dentures fell in between. Now the question came, whose denture is which? These are the cartoons of happiness. Real happiness is, number one, you have no complaints about anything in this world. No complaints. See? If we have nothing to complain, poor God is omnipresent. Oh God, why did you create the world like this? Complain. That is why our gods never listen to our prayers. Because our prayers are nothing but complaints. See, friends, being happy, no complaint, being happy, always alert, being happy is creative, being happy, not talking to yourself, being happy, not gossiping with the whole world. Net result, your all energy will be conserved. Then sky is the limit for you. That doesn't mean we are all the time with a swollen face. What happened? I am getting into realization mode. No. Participate in this world, at the same time, protect yourself from yourself. Gita says, Atmaiva Atmano Bandhu, Atmaiva Ripur Atmanah. And to come out of this chaos of our life, what is required is this simple principle. Start working on your mind. These two things. Before we talk to anybody on any topic, ask a question. This morning we went for a walk. Normally when you go for a walk, people start talking about this, about that. There's no need. Then what I did, I asked myself, I wanted to say something. I said, is it necessary to talk? No, then keep quiet. Then again, after going some time, again, thought comes, I should talk something. Again, the same question, is it necessary to talk? No. And the net result is, you start remaining quieter and quieter, effortlessly. Ashantasya kutasukham. If we are not at peace with ourselves, we can never be happy. And such a person is a burden to himself and to others. Therefore, friends, try this. It is the basic message of Gita. Atmaiva Atmano Bandhu, Atmaiva Ripur Atmanah. We are our friend, we are our enemy. If our mind is under our control, our mind is our friend. If our mind is controlling us, our mind is our enemy. And for this, nobody in the world can help you. You have to work on yourself. Now the last and the most important point. When we think, the thinking is of two types. One type of thinking is that which generates a momentum of thoughts. That momentum of thoughts carries us away. And then we are lost. Just observe next time. When you switch on the fan, there is a good speed, and then switch off the same fan, but the momentum of the movement of the fan blades will keep on moving it for some time. Exactly the same way. When we think, our mind gathers a momentum, and even if we want to keep the mind shut, it keeps on moving. So what is required is, we have to arrest the formation of a momentum of the thoughts. Now what is the momentum of the thought? I'll tell you my experience. I normally get up pretty early. So early morning I want a cup of tea. So the moment I get up, first thought comes, I must have a cup of tea. Will it stop there? No. Where it is available? Where should I go? To whom should I ask? Whether they will be able to give me or not? One after another thought. On the contrary, if the thought is complete in itself, the next thought will not be born. See? Like, you know, suppose I have to come to this place. So one after another thought, oh, I have to get up early in the morning and then I can finish myself, get ready and go to the airport. Then I have got to, after going to the airport, I should catch the flight on time. I should not. One after another thought. But if the thought is complete in itself, for example, this is what is the importance of mantra which Amma tells us. When you chant the mantra, every mantra is complete in itself. Take this example. When you say, I want a cup of tea, next thought is bound to be born. Where will I get it? Like when I was coming from Trivandrum, on the way, I had wanted to have a cup of tea. I said, come on, stop somewhere. Swamiji, next little bit, 5 minutes, 10 minutes. It was, I said, okay, we'll take in Vallika only. No, we'll get it here. Till that tea was given to me, mind is constantly repeating it again and again. Because I want a cup of tea is an incomplete thought. It is not a complete. Now, contrary to that, let there be any complete thought, next thought will not be born. Like the mantra that Mama has given us, Om Namah Shivaya, complete. There is nothing further. Thereafter, let there be a nice silence. And the moment you feel, again some thought is going to be born, again fire a missile. Om Namah Shivaya, Om Namah Shivaya. By this, mind will remain alert, alive, vigilant and quiet. And therefore, it will be fully available for anything that you want to do in life. But when we are carried away by something, then we are in front, but we are not able to see anything. Therefore, give this a good try. Instead of, you know, mechanically, you must be doing it also, mechanically, anusha, 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 anusha. And that anusha, anusha goes in such a manner that even the gods get confused. I don't know what this fellow is calling. Is he calling you? No, that is not my name. I am not Then the other god said, is he calling you? No, this is not my name. What we say, we also don't know. Go slowly, go slowly. Then you are working on your mind. So chanting the name of the Lord should not be like taking Ayurvedic medicine. How do you take Ayurvedic medicine? Do you taste it? Kutajarishta. No. We just take it and take a glass of water, some sweet. Oh God. Chant the Lord's name with this mantra like you eat a chocolate. How do we eat a chocolate? Do we take a chocolate and a glass of water and gulp it? No. We eat, park it in the parking lot and keep on enjoying it for next 20-30 minutes in the same manner. There is no hurry because now you are working on your mind. See, we simply complain about the mind. Instead of complaining about the mind, start working on the mind. This is the difference between the children and the old people. Old people have only complaints about the mind. Children have got inquiry. See? In Hubli, Karnataka, the other day, when I went there, they invited me for a talk among a group of Gujaratis and Sindhis. They say, Swamiji, please give us a talk in Hindi. We don't understand the local language and also much of English. So please talk to us in Hindi. I said, all right. And then when I was going to the stage, one elderly person who was conducting me, he said, Swamiji, please tell, the TV is spoiling our people. They should not watch TV. I said, all right. So I went and started. Dear friends, I was told to talk on TV. So let me start my lecture on TV. TV has spoiled our older generation. So he got up. Swamiji, no, not older generation. I said, I know what I am talking. See, all the time holding on to the TV 24/7, watch this thing. When some their special serial is going on, you go to their house. All of them are watching at the TV. You go that time. Swamiji, how come? Oh, very nice place, sit down. Acha, when did you come? They are not even ready to listen to your reply because so much glued to that. Don't get addicted to anything in life. Whether it is drinks or drugs or habits, no. Protect yourself. And for protection, this is the highest vaccination. Keep on chanting this. Cautiously, slowly, like you are eating a chocolate. In your mind, just try 3 times, but longer gap between the 2 chanting. No hurry. By this technique, we will be able to learn how to control our mind and use that mind for a given purpose. We never take care of our mind. If we can mind our mind, we have done a great service to the whole world. A person with a cool mind alone can achieve anything that is required. This is the basic difference in our approach to the mind and the Western approach to the mind. There was one American lady, she came in one of the yoga conferences. After my talk was over, she said, "I want to discuss with you about mind." I said, "Never mind, let us go and take food and sleep." "No, but I had to go tonight to USA, I don't have time, but I will call you from USA." I said, "Okay, call me." And then she called me. Her daytime or night? I said, "I don't talk at night. I talk only daytime." Next day she called. She said, "I am writing a book about approach to mind according to the Western philosophy and the Eastern philosophy. So please tell me about Eastern philosophy, what is the approach?" I said, "One line approach. We don't talk about unhealthy minds. We talk about the possible dormant potentiality that is hidden in every mind. We don't talk about depression, dejection. No. These are unhealthy conditions. We want to invoke what is the possibility that every one of us have. And that possibility can be encashed if we start working on the mind." What happened to Arjuna on the first day of battle was this. He was confused as to who is he at a given period of time. And by listening the whole Bhagavad Gita, what he concluded, "Now my is gone. I know I have come here on the battlefield. Therefore, I am no more a disciple. I am no more a grandson. I am no more a brother to somebody. But I am a warrior. And the duty of the warrior is to fight the war to win." Exactly the same thing for every one of us at every moment. We are here to study, do your best and achieve the great success in life. But if this time, if we go the wrong way, nobody will be able to help us. Therefore, friends, make the use of this time in your life the best way. Wish you all the best. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om. Sri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.
Om Amruteshwari Namaha. My humble pranams at my beloved Amma and my prostrations at the feet of Swami Anubhavandaji. Now this is really a happy moment for me to give some of my reflections on Swamiji's class. I will conclude very soon. Swamiji used to take classes in ashram for the past 5 years. I have been attending his classes. And 2 years back, Swamiji came here and gave a talk on first chapter of Bhagavad Gita. And all these classes are really inspiring. And a difference that we see in Swamiji's classes is that he is very unofficial, informal in his rendering of the topic. He has traveled vast and he has many experiences from the different parts of the world. And he shares all these parts and all these experiences, and he infuses these experiences to give messages which are very much important for us to lead our life successfully. You might have had an experience or a sample you got today itself. And his message, as you know, is to take life not seriously, but to take life with a purpose in mind. With a goal in mind, we have to live our life. But it should not be a life of seriousness. It should be a life of happiness, joy. And his message, he quotes from Bhagavad Gita, what is the sign of wisdom? Swamiji says, it is na shojati na kamchati. One who is not miserable, one who is able to overcome misery with his own will, with his own sadhana, that person is a wise person. That is what Swami teaches us through his lectures, through his classes of these different scriptures. And I hope all of you enjoyed his class, even though nobody of them, they didn't come forward at the first instance. I think that they enjoyed the class, Swamiji. And Swamiji knows in Kerala, people are a little reluctant to come to the front and give some opinions. Swamiji has said this thing even before in his classes. We Malayalis do not come forward so quickly. They have a hesitance in their mind. So I think Swamiji will understand the psychology of these students and will assess them rightly. They have got the points, and I hope you will put them into practice also. So with these words, I thank Swamiji profusely on all of your behalf and on my own behalf. Thank you, Swamiji, a lot. Namaste.